particular way of periodizing liberalism, and, you know, more specifically for me, settler colonial liberalism. This, I just pulled off my most recent, the last book, in which I call it the symphony. Does it say that? The symphony of late liberalism. Somewhere I call it that. Well, I've never played it. I have a friend who's great. I want to play it. I have no idea what it sounds like. In a nutshell, the logic of the periodization is thusly that around the, you know, 50s, 60s, nothing emerges like that. So somewhere around the 50s and 60s, there comes to emerge globally, although the lower stanza and the higher stanza both can be messed with, so these are not set. But there comes to emerge a form of the governance of difference, the form of governance of markets that are distinct and different from that which existed prior to the 60s through the 70s. And these new forms of governance of difference and governance of markets are responding to two legitimacy crises within liberalism. On the one hand, the governance of difference that emerges in the 70s, which we call multiculturalism, politics of recognition, self-determination in relation to indigenous politics. This form of the governance of difference is responding to a legitimacy crisis thrown up by new social movements, anti-colonial movements, pacifist movements, the non-alignment movement, all of which broke through an imaginary of kind of paternalistic civilizationalism. Right? So we are colonizing, we are governing, we are based on our good paternal instinct to pull you, whatever you are, women, blacks, indigenous, colonized people, into civilization, which we say you can be a part of when you get there, right? So these movements bust that myth, and my argument is that the governance of multiculturalism, politics of recognition, of what we call self-determination, is a response to that puncturing. That is, it's liberalism trying to save itself, right? It's not actually anything about absorbing the critique. Or it is about absorbing the critique, but absorbing in such a way that it flips the problem back to the governed, right? So through multiculturalism, through recognition, through the politics of self-determination, we really see in this country, the liberal state says, ah, Sacre Bleu, we see that we weren't being paternalistic, civilizational, we were actually oppressing. So now we understand that you have something of worth, now you tell us what it is, within a certain kind of legal framework. So it shifts the burden, you see that, from the crisis of the governed to the governing to the burden of the governed. I think we very much see this indigenous self-determination. But an interesting thing happens at the same time, which is the crisis of markets. And around the same time, we see a form of, it's not one form of Keynesianism, but a general form of Keynesianism in the late 60s and early 70s, think here of the oil crisis, stagflation. This mode of governing markets is hitting a legitimacy crisis as well. It's not working. And it's not working in the context of competing at that time viable alternatives, i.e. socialist, communist blocs. So there's another way of governing markets that's sitting there, right? So that liberalism of the post-war, pre-70s, has to come up with a way of solving the problem, the governance of the markets, that's not socialism and that's not communism, and that's the re-emergence through Reagan, Thatcherism, and in a much different circuitous path into Australia, what we now call neoliberalism. And in a nutshell, for me, neoliberalism can be defined as the moment in which markets break out of the market and become the definer of all forms of value. This is very different than Keynesianism, and it's very different than what we would call Adam Smith liberalism. Because Adam Smith, for those just, you can forget all this, I'm just giving you background, but for those of you who remember, Adam Smith has two books, right, Wealth of Nations and Moral Sentiments, and he's very clear across the two of them that, yes, the market works by its own invisible hand, it should be left alone, but the market and the values of the market and the logic of the market should not define all values in the social. As a matter of fact, Adam Smith, whether he's right or wrong, doesn't matter. Nevertheless, Adam Smith argues that it would be a disaster if the market defined all values. You have to cultivate, and this is what, in some ways, what it talks about in moral sentiments, you have to cultivate a kind of moral sentiment outside the market to constitute a subject that then will enter the market, which is operating by its own invisible hand. Neoliberalism is able to bust the wall, if you will, and say now markets have broken out of the market and will define all social values. Mm-hmm. Political, intimate, anything can be understood, quantified, and should be valued vis-a-vis market logics. Okay, so anyways, voila. For a long time, I've been interested in, or in the last three books, I've been interested in fact, last two books, something that I call, like, what is the governance of the otherwise in late liberalism now? And if that's late liberalism, otherwise, the otherwise is that which is imminent in, but has yet to become an actual form of life. So it's imminent in the social field, but it's not anything yet. Could be, couldn't be, but it's not yet. So it's an otherwise rather than an other. Last two books, Empire of Love, Economies of Abandonment. Empire of Love, try to understand the governance of the otherwise in late liberalism through the problem of affect. So that was its main problem. And the argument was that intimacy, or what we would call love, is a critical technology by which the otherwise is governed. That we think love is just something we have and that we hope will, you know, I hope I fall in love one day. We're getting a little old for that, I am. But anyways, as something you hope will happen to you, right? And this hope, the argument of the book is this hope is not external to late liberalism, but is formed out of it. The last book, Economies of Abandonment, was more interested in the problem of narration and put pressure on the question of event and tense, and in particular, the kinds of events that many of us are familiar with who work in, not disaster capital, which we get a lot of publicity around, but kind of non-disaster capitalism, the cruddy eventfulness of, say, indigenous communities all over Australia or in the suburbs. That is, you know, every once in a while there's a huge riot or there's a murder or something bad, but usually it's these teeny tiny things that you wouldn't even say anything happened, like the car broke down again, or someone lost the welfare card, the basic card. Yeah, how could I not know that? Basic card, or that we were trying to haul a couch over to the community and it fell off the truck. Well, it's like no one died, but it's a tsunami of what we would call these quasi-events, these events that are not even eventful, but that nevertheless swamp life. And how do we think about the governance of the otherwise vis-a-vis this kind of event that doesn't, it's hard to see, it's hard to have an ethical relationship to, and it's hard to create a politics around. Okay, so this first two. The last volume in this whole governance of the otherwise in late liberalism is putting pressure on the problem of finitude, and is in the shadow of conversations about the Anthropocene, which we began talking about a little bit, I think, almost. And the central problem, which it shouldn't be surprising at all, since that's all what I'm about to say is the only thing we talk about, which is the problem of life. Right? But what I want to put pressure on is the problem of finitude and how the problem of finitude is central to what I call the governance of the otherwise in late liberalism. So, and this is where the carbon imaginary emerges. Like if you think what the problem of finitude in the Anthropocene, or what you'll hear me calling the contemporary geontology, geos ontology, ontology being, right, geos Geos, Earth.
Okay.
Then I started playing around trying to think, and you'll see where it comes from, but I started thinking, what are the... If the problem of finitude is, central figure is in some ways life, and we should know this through the long conversation in Foucault and Esposito and critical theory for a while now, biopower, right? So biopolitics, biopower, which is life, the power, the organization of power through life. What would we have to do in terms of our key figures if it wasn't biopower we were interested in, that is, life that already assumes bios, biology, biochemistry, but rather we broke the hold that a certain kind of figuration of life had on both critical theory, governance, and et cetera? What kind of figures would emerge that we could work with? And here I just, in some ways, you should, those of you who know Foucault would know why I'm doing this. If you remember, Foucault is writing Histories of Sexuality at the same time that he's doing his Collège de France lectures on what came to be known, the three great lectures on biopolitics. Society Must Be Defended, territory security, population, and then crime and freedom, the birth of politics. And across those lectures and in The History of Sexuality, Volume 1, Foucault describes four figures of sexuality that are vital to understanding the condition of liberalism that we're living through. Now, this is his words, the condition, what is this liberalism we're living through? He's writing in the 70s. So, in the 70s, when Foucault's trying to figure out what is this liberalism we're living through, what is this thing that's emerging, which I would say was indeed emerging, right? This new kind of governance of difference and governance of markets is emerging, he's totally right. And he's writing 60s, 70s, 72, he's writing on the, what is this thing we're in? And in order to understand what this thing we're in, Foucault says, actually, if we look at four figures, we're going to understand something really interesting. The four figures he looks at to understand the governance of his time, of liberalism of his time, are very famously the hysterical woman, the masturbating child, the perverse adult, and the Malthusian couple. And he brings up these four. So the hetero couple, the perverse adult becomes kind of homo, or queer, the masturbating child, or the sexualized child, and the hysterical woman. And so he's saying, these are these four figures through which we can understand the formation of power within, we're within. And the reason he thinks these four figures are so important is that it's through life that this new kind of liberalism is working. But it's working at two levels, life at two levels. On the one hand, the level of population, right, the management of population, humans as species. So things like sexuality become crucial. Both, so the Malthusian couple, right, become absolutely central if governance is happening through population. And at the other hand, if we think about power happening through these intimate formations, once again, sexuality and gender become really important. So he puts a lot of pressure on the question of sexuality and the question of reproduction. But if we say that, okay, fine, we're in, like that we might have been organizing through population, I can talk about that later, but are we still in late liberalism? Did something happen, if it starts in the 70s, 67, does something happen in the 2001, 2008? Well, what kinds of things have happened? One, the governance of difference has hit a new kind of crisis, right? In which you have in Europe, you have in Australia, think Howard, think Sarkozy, think Merkel, think Cameron, all of these state leaders make public announcements post 9/11, 7/7, that multiculturalism is a failed experiment. Right? The intervention, in some ways, is the policy end of a set of statements that are not just in Australia, but in Europe and elsewhere, saying that this experiment that started in the 70s isn't working, and so we're not doing it anymore. Now, what's not working? Well, they're right, it's not working if multiculturalism, politics of recognition, self-determination was supposed to solve the problem of difference for liberals. Then they're right, it's not working. And they're right, it didn't work. That's what it was supposed to do. It wasn't supposed to actually puncture liberalism or let difference in or create the space of an otherwise. No, it was supposed to solve the crisis that we were having about our own form of governance. And so, and by 2001, it was like, well, this is not working. They're in enclaves, they're not behaving well, they don't believe in our liberal system, therefore we're going to crash it, because it was never about anything but that. Same time, 2008, boom, what happens? We have the crisis in neoliberal capital. So the markets fail, and we still don't know quite what is China going to be able to do, something that no country really has ever been able to do, which is hop over low-end production into higher-end production. And it's very unclear whether they're going to be able to do this. And so there comes to be a crisis here. But a third crisis emerges around the same time that was always in liberalism, but became very clear around the 2000s, and now is absolutely in crisis, and that is the Anthropocene. That is, the question is no longer the governance of life, in some ways, but the problem of finitude, life in relation to what may be a radical kind of end, and that's the Anthropocene. Right? So climate change, the Anthropocene. What would happen if we don't say, well, the kinds of theorizations we had to understand the beginning of what I call late liberalism are sufficient to understand what might be the tail end of late liberalism, or I think what Helen was calling the end of the tether of modernity. I don't use modernity, But I agree with you that there's something happening now that we could have a certain kind of Foucauldian attitude toward, or even a Kantian attitude, read on that way. Without saying he had all the tools to do it. It's just like, how do you do a Marxism in a different kind of capital? So what would happen if we said, okay, well, something's shifting again, and now with the Anthropocene, with the problem of climate change, the problem of life is now the occasion of finitude. Do we need new figures? So in this new book, there are three figures that I'm thinking through. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to talk about the three figures, what I mean by the carbon imaginary, and then I'm going to say what other kinds of imaginaries there are existing, and why probably we won't have them, and that's why it's called the Requiem to Late Liberalism, because we had I'm very bad these days. I think it's already over. We had a chance. They still have a chance of sitting right there, but no one's going to do anything. Eduardo de Castro, who's a very well-known Brazilian anthropologist, part of the animist group, the extended French animist crew. We were in Normandy, and he said, we were talking, it was kind of getting on the Anthropocene, and he said, you know, what's really interesting is that people, and he meant, you know, basic capital liberal, have an easier time imagining the end of the world than the end of capitalism. And I think that's right. So, remember, what I'm saying here is a requiem, but I'm saying it's kind of chipper way. Okay. So what I'm going to talk about, I'm really speaking of geontologies, one of which is defined by a carbon imaginary, one of which is defined by certain forms of non-carbon imagined obligations that I'll talk about that have to do with very old friends of mine, some of who are passed away, but some of who are not. And then another form of another geontology that doesn't emerge from, you know, the kind of classic other, because the folks I'm talking about are not the other, they're the otherwise, but another metaphysics within the Western metaphysics. So I'll see how far I get. Is that cool? Right. Okay. So the carbon imaginary, what do I mean by that? If I'm interested in geontologies, that is not ontology, because ontology, you'll see, I think, presupposes a carbon imaginary. But geontologies, that is, opening being to geos, not just bios. Okay. What do I mean by carbon imaginary? By carbon imaginary, I mean something really quite simple. It won't even seem like anything to, even it'll seem absurd, it's so simple. All I mean is that a certain kind of imaginary, which is has institutional expressions, discursive expressions, etc., in which the separation of life from non-life is based on specific metabolic processes, or imagined metabolic processes, with the key events of these metabolic processes being birth, growth, and death. Rather than, life and non-life are separated, that which is alive and that which is life and that which is non-life, is separated based on metabolic processes. And there are other ways in which you can imagine the separation. You can imagine in terms of movement, you can imagine in terms of mental capacities, etc. You can think of lockdown syndrome, locked-in syndrome, I could have gone that way to life, non-life, but what locked-in syndrome, I don't want to go there, because in locked-in syndrome, we just end up in the problem of bios and zoe, is this locked-in person qualified life or just life, right? And that's not what I'm looking at. That's not what I want to put pressure on. Rather, what I want to put pressure on, because even a locked-in person can die. Right? And it's birth, growth, potential reproduction. I didn't reproduce, but, I could have, supposedly. And death. And death is the big one. Right? This drama, that we're heading toward death. Why did you bring me in this world to die, right? What can be killed, etc. The reason I want to actually put pressure on metabolism as that which defines life and separates life from non-life is that it's this presupposition that informs, in a deep way, the natural sciences, the human and the social sciences, critical theory, the critical of critical theory, state governance, and capitalist markets. And you think, well, why not? Because it's true. Okay, so I'm going to back us into that. So let me just give some examples. In the life sciences, for instance, we see, and my oldest sister is a biochemist, so I kind of check this with her and make sure. Right? And then she gives me articles, and I read them the way we do. But there's nothing, absolutely nothing remarkable about what I'm about to say. The life sciences are in critical ways defined, at least in one domain, as trying to figure out the process by which geological matter gained the functions and dynamics of metabolism, and thus biochemical processes. So how was it that geochemical processes changed such that we suddenly got biochemical processes? From geological, you wouldn't say life, geological stuff, entity stuff, the miracle of biological, and here we throw in life, emerges. Again, this is just a big field, right? So, in a paper in physical biology, there was a sentence that's really useful here, in which it's a review paper, and the argument is that the emergence of metabolic processes and functions relies on carbon fixation. This sentence is, carbon fixation is the centerpiece of metabolism, the basic process by which cells taking chemicals from their environment and build them into products they need to live. It is also the link between the geochemistry of the Earth and the biochemistry of life. Right? So you just see that right there. There's Earth and there's life on Earth. And the more that we look for the processes under which this happened, historical, geological, the more that presupposition that there is a separation gets pushed into the background of the natural sciences. See that? Instead of examining the presupposition, you just push it into it by trying to figure out what allowed this separation. But in some ways, we see the same issue going on in what we might say would be the opposite of the natural sciences or life sciences, that is critical theory. Like, what could be more critical than critical of the natural and life sciences and critical theory over the last 30 years when we've punctured the problem of essence? There are no essences anymore. It's very hard to have an essence. You can't sit point in nature and say anything, blah, blah, blah. And yet, what we see in, which I think in some ways is true, though I do think math saves it. Nevertheless, critical theory has remains captured by the imaginary of finitude defined by this life, this carbon imaginary, right? So if you think Heidegger's famous ontological shift, well, we're going to do ontology, we return to ontology, but not just to return, but to reshape it. And you have Derrida famously trying to, you know, in his essay, Ends of Man, and a bunch of other ones, trying to puncture human being has on metaphysics. So he sits there and says, we have to puncture this, we have to puncture it. We have to puncture it, we have to puncture it. His whole critical stance is trying to break the grip of Heidegger's Dasein, which is life, the being, a certain kind of being, human being, which lifts itself out of other kinds of beings because of the problem of its finitude. It's its finitude that makes Dasein, or humans, concerned with the being. They're the being concerned with being because they face death in a different way, right? And Derrida's like, you know, tries to, you know, at least puts it under pressure. But what interestingly happens in the 70s, at the same time, is Foucault, who I like, but Foucault comes up and says, wait a minute. Governance is all defined by the governance of life, biopolitics and biopower. And the whole problem of life as Dasein and finitude gets taken off the table because now we're looking at the politics, the governance of, the formation of power through the governance of life. Or with the Sheila Mbembe and others, necropolitics or governance through death and poverty. And as a result, we have Bios and Zoe, we have Butler with performativity and precarity, but what's not been knocked off the table or even unsettled at all is the fact that we're still mainly concerned with life. And a particular kind of life, the kinds of lives that can be born, can grow, and can die. And we remain, here with Peter saying, we remain mainly concerned with those which are concerned, that even know that they're alive. Right? So you kind of build this hierarchy based on a life thing's awareness of its own life. But you can scale really easily, so you can get pull in like the new animal movement, pull in the post-human, right? Still not getting rid of this fundamental division. Pull in our vegetarians with angst about carrots.
That's not me.
That's not Tess. But it's the reason we have angst about carrots is because can carrots feel pain? The whole diagnostic of self-awareness kicks in. But self-awareness depends on that initial birth thing. And it depends more fundamentally, I think, on its ability to not necessarily be murdered, but to die. I think capital, and I'll come back to this, works in exactly, that is, capital also scales based on this hierarchy of life. Thus, why the carbon imaginary is interesting to me right now is that it's kind of undoubtable. It cuts across very distinct disciplinary formations, has a certain kind of, yeah, but, you know, what exactly are you saying? Isn't this to it? That is, it functions as a, what again, Blake Wittgenstein would call, not, it's a particular kind of, what he would call a particular kind of proposition. It's an hinge or axial proposition. That is, it creates an axial center around which everything else spins. So you can't actually question it because it's just the basis of everything else. And so with Wittgenstein, he says, when you get one of these things, this is in his later Sprachspiel, the language game stuff, there's only so far you can go in questioning and doubting before you hit the axis, and it's just like, well, that's just the way it is. 1 + 1 = 2. It just is. You know? There just is a difference between life and non-life. I mean, what do you want me to do? And he would say, the reason that it's undoubtable is that the whole life world is built up around certain ones of these axial principles. Right? Okay. And I am saying that the carbon imaginary is one, is a central one, and is absolutely critical then to the governance of the otherwise, especially right now. And I just want to move now to more locally, kind of like territory Australia, and give us just some concrete examples of what I mean by this. By what I mean by the argument that the carbon imaginary is central to the governance of the otherwise. And I think it's been central from the beginning to the end. Right? So let's look at the beginning. Let's think about the governance of difference. Remember, governance of difference, governance of markets, 70s to like 2000s, late mid-2000s. In the early part, carbon was this carbon imaginary where there's absolute, undoubtable division between non-life and life. There's biochemistry and there's geochemistry. There's Earth and there's life. That's just, I mean, okay. When we have the governance of, the emergence of a governance of difference in Australia in the 70s around self-determination, which it's taken me a while even to be able to say that out loud. It's just so, it's such an abomination to say that this was about self-determination. But that's what we called it. In the beginning, and cutting of recognition, trying to say this fairly clearly, in the 70s, in the moment in which the crisis of the legitimacy, the governance of the otherwise, turned into recognition politics, legislation, affect, ordinary discourse, increasingly the institutions developed and creating around and through the Land Rights Act, in crucial ways, pivoted on this carbon imaginary by saying to Indigenous men and women groups, be different enough, right, so that we can recognize your difference and pull it into the nation, but not too different so that we experience, that is, the we of the liberal subject, experiences our own repugnance toward you. Now, that was internal to liberalism, and Cunning, I try to explain that. That wasn't actually them and us. That was us projecting out on them. You saw the problem that we have with ourselves. Are we good people, or are we people who want to kill people? Which one is it? You solve that problem. Right? You perform to us a way of solving our problem. That's what the argument is. The carbon imaginary was a really great way of solving this problem. So you had Indigenous people saying, this tree, this rock, this river, this wind, is alive. It hears us, it smells us, it births us, all of us. And it functioned perfectly in the governance of the otherwise because, on the one hand, it made no difference in terms of the actual governance because it was absolutely, undoubtedly untrue. That it allowed people to seem really different so you could touch the weirdness. And it would absolutely never touch liberal understandings of what I would call geontology, because it was absolutely, undoubtedly false. Rocks could not listen, nor could they birth you. But wow, you guys are really different because you think that. At the end here, something very different starts happening when the mining boom starts happening. Then we see a flip that this belief is a bad belief because it gets in the way of capital, it gets in the way of the enterprise subject, it gets away of all these things. So you flip the equation without getting rid of it. That is, we never believed that rocks could listen. And now we're saying that you believe that rocks can listen is why you're not getting into the full enterprise capitalist society. And you see very clearly now, of course, that no one ever believed any of this. But it was a carbon imagining very absolutely crucial to the governance of difference. It's also been crucial to the governance of markets. And here it becomes really much more, I have to lay out the argument a little, and I'm going to lay it out longer in the book. But the ability to separate geological matter from life is, as we know, has been crucial to the generation of wealth and hierarchies of labor extraction, since, I don't know, capital. In the current moment, though, what has become quite interesting is that a certain kind of self-awareness within liberal capital, so the governance of the market, in which carbon is both the condition of the market, that is fuel, carbon-based fuel, but it is also potentially the condition of the end of carbon life. So carbon became fuel, creates markets, the first through coal, oil, these new gas sands that were fracking all over the place. But it also, then carbon use might create the end of carbon-based life. And in folks' imaginary, the end of life. And so thus three figures, I think, have emerged. And this is where I'm just going to kind of pop along and then give two examples and hopefully be done. In this period we're in now, which is, what is it? And a part of this is really in the spirit. What is this we're in now? How does putting pressure on the understanding of late liberalism through this thing called the carbon imaginary help us? Well, three figures that they're not the four figures of sexuality anymore. I think those are, I don't think we should be thinking sexuality, gender. I don't even know if we should be thinking race, per se. What figures should be now? And three, there could be 20, I don't care. These are three I think are useful. One is the desert. And notice there's a tar road there. So there's desert. But the desert for me, the figure of the desert, not just the desert, but it's also Mars, right? And there's also a road here. And again, think of the discourse around the problem of Mars, and also the technologies that are being invested in trying to find out if there was life on Mars. Could there be life elsewhere? Where is life? Can we go further in the universe and try and find life? Is Mars our future? With Mars being the figure of non-life, the desert. The desert is where life is not. But it's also, the desert is also, I think, zombies. A kind of form of, a kind of space of human sociality radically emptied and just turned into radical consumption. Like the zombie is just like, there's no self-awareness. It's just like an eating machine. It's dead, it's not alive, but it's not quite, this might be Bias and Zoe, but it's Bias and Zoe that's turning everything into a desert. And it's also interesting because, of course, movies are doing this, so The Road, you know, the consequence of the novel, and the novel, which is quite good, and the movie, which I never saw the movie, but I heard it wasn't bad. And, of course, Australia's great because we started it all with Mad Max. So on the one hand, the desert is something that's quite interesting to think about because we see the desert, or I would say within the carbon imaginary, the desert is a place of non-life. The other figure is, I'm coming back to that in other imaginaries, the other figure is the what's arisen now, and you're not going to be able to hear this, but it's going, wow, 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 just think of a Kennedy. Oh, yeah, you are hearing it. And you see this across critical theory, you see it in a lot of people talking about the Anthropocene and climate change. The figure of the animus and the totemus has reemerged. That is a kind of human sociality that doesn't believe in the doesn't operate within the carbon imaginary the way we do. And a lot of critical theorists are saying, let's go to the animus as a way, a place in which we can rethink and save the planet, because they didn't kill the planet. The trouble is, of course, is that these animists, you know, my friends and family, have to make their way through these older forms of governance of difference in which they're stereotyped, they have a certain sound environment, right? They're on stamps already. We are expecting certain kinds of relationships between how people look and what they do, and right? So these new figures don't just pop up out of nowhere with nothing existing. This older governance of recognition still exists as well. But nevertheless, the desert and the animus have emerged as these two critical figures that we have to really pay attention to. Why are we looking at deserts all the time? Why are we looking at animus all the time? The third figure is, of course, the terrorist. But the terrorist isn't simply Islamic. The terrorist is, especially in the U.S., is also green. Green terrorists. Is in the U.S., the green movement is our number one domestic terrorists. We've built a whole sorts of new prison cells for them. There's a whole security apparatus that's been devised for nothing but the green scare. What's interesting, of course, about the terrorist is that at least in the U.S. imaginary, the terrorist is associated with the desert and is also associated with non-Christian forms of belief, sometimes animist, usually Islamic, obviously. But there's this dense discursive circuit that are going through these three figures. All of which keep on saying to us, we're about to, you know, life is at an end, life is at an end, life is at an end. But life understood in a very particular way, that is, under the imaginary, within this drama, I should say, drama of birth, growth, death, that's defined by metabolism. And thus, you can get life and geos separated. All I want to do in the last 10 minutes is simply say there are other, and I actually think that separation, it will indeed lead us to deserts, zombies, and maybe some animists at the end. Margaret Atwood has a new book, a new series of books that are really interesting to read on this one. But there are otherwise, there are other geontologies, there are other ways of thinking about being, outside of this particular carbon imaginary. And all I want to do is simply point to two. One is very local. It comes from, I don't ever know how many times I'm going to have to hit this thing. It comes from right around here. Oops. Did I say I hit it too many times? Oh, and there they went. That was too fast. Come back. Come back. There you go. It was practice, and still is practice in many ways, from the coast, from, you know, other side of the harbor down to Anson Bay and beyond. And with a very different understanding of the relationship between potential forms of life and non-life. It's not as if everything's alive within these worlds. But rather, certain things are alive, and everything could be. So let me give you a little background and then run you through it. So people I'm, old friends of mine, in the history that's told, this happened, whether it did or not, we don't know. But basically, the same period that the killing times that Tess was talking about, during those killing times, people who lived down along the coast were shot out or migrated up, and then were in the during the after Second World War interned on a place called Elizabeth, that later became Belleuen. And during this, from the late 40s through the 70s, the folks who were living there faced a real question, which was how to turn radical dislocation and the violences of the colonial period into location and belonging. And they, a group of, there were like, you know, I talked about like 8-10 people who were extraordinarily smart about patterns and levels. So analytically, they worked really incredibly with patterned levels, layers of territoriality and kinship, which, you know, I could go on all day. But what they basically did is they put pressure on their own presuppositions about substance, composition, and obligation to solve the problem of violent settler colonialism. So by substance, they were thinking of various kinds of substance come out of mouths, like language, sweat, ritual substances, blood, that through different activities were layered into places. Each activity had its own kind of rhetorical form, so a ritual has a rhetorical form in certain kinds of substances. Language and hunting has another kind of form, other kinds of substance, sweat mainly, et cetera, like that. And so they were very particular what kinds of substances do what kind of things, but as you're doing various things, you're putting various substances literally into Earth. Over time, these substances compose territoriality in relation to a territoriality that's already there, but also is pulling up things that were imminently there. So this is an incredible analytics that are saying what is there and what is imminently there. And it does so, on the one hand, by the substance themselves having a certain kind of extension. Or even if you think about walking in a mangrove, when you walk in, I don't know if you guys do this, but if you walk in a mangrove and you go crabbing a lot, you create a path. And then you go on that path. And then you go on that path again until that is a path. Ditto with creeks and rivers and all sorts of things. That is, the mangrove is interpreting the human. And in interpreting the human by growing around it or opening up, it creates the human as a certain kind of interpreting subject. You see that? And as it the and it, you watch the country, and as that opens up and interprets you, and then you are pulled into its logic, you start becoming from it, literally, kind of composed out of it. And so you'll see that I actually invert these anthropological triangles. Usually you see descent going down, and they very much saw descent going up, working in and then out, in and then out. Now, in prior to radical dislocation, perhaps these backgrounds weren't really noticed that much because where you were moving was more, you know, it might have been more here rather than there. But once it was lifted out, then the presupposition people were having came to the foreground and was working there. Now, what was interesting is that for them, the point wasn't really to discover the truth about the place and the way in which liberalism thinks about truth, that is, propositionally. That is, tell me the truth about this area. It is X. Oh, thank you. Now I have it. And I'll put it in my backpack and I'll walk away. Right? And I'll take what you say is true and I'll line it up to other ways of producing truth, and then I'll decide which truths produce better truths or something like that. Rather, for them, truth is what they were trying to do is not only learn something true, but more importantly, in the process of learning, you created the person and the place is obligated one to the other. And the opening of the mangrove is an example of that. That is, as you come to learn the mangrove, it comes to shape you. So you could say the mangrove and the person are internal to each other. You can say the ground and the person, we're still quite literal about it. It's not very spiritually difficult at all. You piss in the ground, it grows something, you eat it, you shit in the ground, it comes back up again. And in some ways are at the fundamental, and then there's other things that have to do with ritualized activity that, you know, men's women, you can or can't say. But in this kind of core fundamental, in this radical dislocation, core fundamental co-constitution of the people in place, put into place. And in this, there was not a division between life and non-life in the way in which we define it. There was a circulation of forms of entities. Not everything was alive, but everything could be because of this co-constitution. And thus, the onus on the human was to, on the one hand, turn the country toward you to make it responsive, and of course, be responsive to how it's, the country is turning toward you or turning away. And there's in Emmy, there's a very particular way in which we say this. In Creole, it's basically a translation in which, I don't know in Yulaland whether this is a kind of ethics, a kind of casual ethics, but giving someone your backbone, giving backbone, do you say that? Which is a bad thing. Like when you give your backbone to each other, unless you're leaning against them, then you're radically turning away from each other, and what you're doing is you're creating a zone of non-responsiveness. You're creating, in fact, a desert. You're creating a space in which one form will not give sustenance to another form. Thus, if we think, and the politics of this, I could walk the politics through this in early liberalism, late liberalism, and late liberalism, but I won't. Instead, I just want to make the simple point that in this way of thinking about geontology, this geontology, the desert isn't a place of non-life. The desert is a form of being that has radically given its backbone to other forms of being. That is, when we look at the desert, it's not lifeless. It's saying, we don't want your form of life. Something very different happens ethically, I think, and morally when you read it that way. Oops, I don't know why I did that. So, much to say that, I just want to put that on the table. The other, another geontology exists that has, that's inside our metaphysics. And I'll just say what it is and not go into much detail. That is, we don't actually have to necessarily go somewhere else in the sense of, if liberalism wants to find an alternative to its carbon imaginary, it can stay within itself. And I think this is somewhat of what Helen might have been doing the other day. And here we would then turn to a number of what I would and others have called other metaphysics, the other metaphysics. It's not the other metaphysics, because it's not the, there's many other metaphysics. One of which is ripe to be plumbed and put in conversation with, say, the geontology of the saltwater folks from, say, across the harbor dam. Put in conversation. That is, not explain, not be the same thing as, not substitute, but put in conversation. The other metaphysics that would be really cool to put in conversation with this geontology comes out of American pragmatics. And in particular, this real, you know, one of our brilliant folks, also a lunatic, a coke shooter, because he had facial what is that when your nerves are so facial Yeah, that's the one. Charles Sanders Peirce. And Peirce's model of semiotics is interesting as a way of breaking out of the carbon imaginary. So we can break out of the carbon imaginary. The interpreting, I don't think subject's right, but the interpreting, he would say the interpretant, but we can say the interpretant, well, I'm just going to say something like shrimp scampi. You know why that's just shrimp, right? Well, the interpreting agent is kind of like shrimp, is in no way either necessarily characterized by nor reaches its apotheosis in the human or in language, human language. For him, we have to we understand mind vis-a-vis the notion of the interpretant, which is for him, again, I'm not going to order, is one of three, the object sign interpretant. And it's this semiotic movement. So there's not, like in a semiology, Saussurean semiology, it's not static, it's just always figuring. So the mind is, semiotics is, for him, is mind is semiotics. But mind isn't confined to humans, and it's also not confined to life. So for Peirce, we can say, and it's not a metaphor, that the riverbed is an interpretant of the river. Gravity is an interpretant of a prior relationship between, well, it's a relationship of preterm prior sign and object. And might become interpreted by something else, so that gravity no longer is. So he's very, everything becomes a habit through this flow of interpretation. And the interpretant is not confined to the life side of the life, non-life. And so, and again, this is, I'm not really explaining how this works. I'm more than happy to go on and on about it. But it just so you know, it just sits there as a potential for, again, breaking out of the carbon imaginary. And I'll end here by just saying, why do we need to break out of the carbon imaginary? I think one of the reasons we need to break out of the carbon imaginary is that, especially now, under the pressure of the Anthropocene, climate change, etc., all our responses to climate change, to what we call the Anthropocene, some geologists have coined the Anthropocene, are based on and move from the drama of human finitude. It's the fact that humans are going to cease to exist. That's the problem. When we care about Earth or other inhabitants therein, we care only insofar as they will or will not be here to help us continue. And as long as I think we continue that drama, that is, there's life and there's non-life, and then in life there's a hierarchy of being based on this metabolism and self-awareness about it, the more unlikely we're ever going to actually turn to other forms of existence, which are constantly saying, we don't want you around here anymore. Or at least, and it's not in the language, it's not like we don't want you around here anymore. It is, as an interpretant, it's manifesting, it's figuring that decision. And then we kind of won't be. And a part of me thinks, well, who cares? And that's why it's a requiem. Because I think, well, if you really wanted to be around, then you have to break out of your imaginary. Either do kind of bust this thing through, say, a purse, you could probably bust it that way, bust it this way. There's a lot of ways you can bust your carbon imaginary. But a lot of things would have to go along the way. And I don't think anyone wants them to go at the end. That's a book in a nutshell.
Not an article, it's a book.
Yeah, it's a book. I'm being arrested for being a green terrorist.
Sorry. Okay, questions and comments.
When I hear the carbon imagery and ontologies, against geontologies, one of the things I keep hearing is dualisms against monisms.
Yeah.
And I keep saying to myself, okay, yeah, there's each, to say it one way and say it the other, has certain allowances or affordances,
I suppose.
And so I'm trying to get at some of the affordances of setting the carbon imaginary against geontologies.
Yeah, I think this is just me being confusing in my presentation, or working through this as I go, as I'm not presenting here, but also using audiences, guinea pigs. I actually think, rather than, so if we go Heidegger, you know, reintroduce the problem of ontology, and in some ways we, in critical theory, we've been living with that for a while.
Yeah.
Even biopower, biopolitics, you think Esposito, right, yeah, exactly, okay. So at the uppermost framing isn't a dualism between the carbon imaginary and geontology, but geontology.
The same monism allows dualism.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say, in some ways, I would say, like, on your side, I would say, well, it's still a monism to say geontology rather than ontology. The affordance, though, is hopefully not to have a singularity, but to say, oh, wait a minute, we can't really say that. You might be able to have being, but even then the Heideggerian being is still really defined by life. I mean, that Dasein is pretty.
Yes.
I mean, he might have gone from life to being, but it's still very, So I wanted a little bit to sit there not as the thing now, but rather like, wait, you can't, that really doesn't make any sense. And that's why it sits up there. And then I say the carbon imaginary is one of many geontologies that didn't come in order like this, but are just here around us, every which way. You know, they're all here, and they're built into different kinds of institutions with differential forms of power, so the geontology that I'm describing across the harbor, some of us live in Palmerston, so that's right down the road, doesn't have the force to make its way through the world or into the world, right? Whereas this carbon imaginary is just like, you know, it's just the way I pick up my cup. So that's what I did.
So I wonder if purse has the fourth.
Has the fourth?
Force.
Oh, the force, yeah. Purse has the force to make its way. Well, you know, it's really interesting because the more radical interventions that he's making in semiotics, in terms of his kind of metaphysics, were made later in his life. And a lot of people don't really, they think that's when he became a little mad or something. And one of the reasons I begin the talk, or I might probably begin the book, by saying, look, there's a certain kind of undoubtability, or you can't doubt this division. Look, and because it cuts across all these things that are both in line with each other and seemingly opposed to each other. Is that to make your way through the world, like if you want to do the kind of things you were doing on Wednesday, or Tessa's trying to make another history, you can show it, but can it do it? You know what I mean? Can it do it? I'm very much a pragmatist. Can it do anything? Right? I can say that my coin, the value is in this coin, this 20-cent piece, and I can believe that. And I can have a whole theory organized around that this coin has 20 cents in it. Not that coin, or like the gold standard. But I can't do anything practically with that belief. And that's why I begin with, like, what if critical theory and the life sciences and capitalism all have the same carbon imaginary? How can purse make its way? What would have to change for it to, and that's what the American pragmatists were really great at, James and Peirce. And that's, I think, what Eduardo's really interesting about. You know, you can't just have a thought. Something's got to end.
So you had the three figures, desert, and in the middle,
animists
and totemists. So, step through how the pointing to alternate geontologies isn't just buying straight into your.
Well, no. The reason I looked there is in
and
fact.
I meant to imagine, you know,
it's because if you think of Foucault, and I'm just back. If you think Foucault's four figures of sexuality as necessary, as, you know, why were these four figures, he says, why did these four figures keep popping up? He didn't just find them and decide, oh, look, I think I'll select these four. They kept emerging. So these are the four, like, if we characterize them like this, right, they're doing that because of a formation of power that works through life, and these four figures are fundamental figures of sexuality is a figuration of life, species life, etc. Health of the subject and the population. So I say these figures keep on, you know, you go around, these figures keep on popping up. Maybe there's a couple more, I don't know. I keep on hearing desert. And again, desert is not just a desert. The desert, that's where the Islamic terrorists come from, that's what Mars is, that's what Mad Max is, somehow these, you know, the road, like desert, desert, desert. What the hell's going on with the desert? It's where oil is, it's where, like, we can, if we don't have any people there, then we can do big uranium mines, blah, 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 blah. The animists, the totemists, the animists everywhere, the animists, totemists, especially the climate change people, the animists and totemists, they have different ideas of human species relationships, human geological relations. They are the answer, they are the answer, they are the answer. The terrorist, who is the one who refuses the order of liberalism, rather green or Islamic or whatever it is, or is indigenous, like anything that refuses the order, terrorist, terrorist, terrorist. So I am not, of course, would not be surprised that any alternative would somehow be absorbed into these three figures, or themselves are already prefiguring the figures. Okay. They are, these three figures are the distortions of these alternatives. Now, Peirce is interesting because in some ways are these, the philosophical, it's like that he's not a figure. But if he manifested, if there was a movement, kind of Peircean metaphysics, I bet you $150 that the image that would be grabbed and recharacterized and struggled over would kind of be animist, totemist, green, something that would then be flipping back and forth in this governance. All around the, they're not acknowledging the hierarchies of life, or they're not acknowledging the undoubtable division between, come on, it's a rock, and it's a human baby. Are you really telling me that the rock is more important than the human baby? That kind of, like, it's the same thing as, are you, with the intervention, are you telling me you don't care about sexual abuse of children? You want to save this rock versus, and so that's what I'm trying to do with figures.
Yeah.
Is that they actually function on both sides.
Yeah.
That
will
make
yeah.
And one of the things with the desert that fascinated me that worked in Valgo a couple of years, and the Aboriginal people there are very different, to me, they're very different to the Aboriginal people I experienced in Kakadu. To me, the rocks were alive because the Aboriginal people, to me, come out of the rocks. Can you understand that? That they
the water voices.
They had grown out of the rocks.
Yeah.
And the people in Kakadu never think that.
I don't know if folks over that way. But saltwater this way, there are a lot of places that people come out of. And you know, I can bend it down to make it, and I actually like doing this because it's like the late Wittgenstein argument about the specific kinds of propositions, what you call axial propositions, that you can't actually doubt them. You can switch. It's also kind of conversion that can take place. But when he talks about conversion, it's very. Seems like, you know, you could just convert, but if you're embedded in an actual thicker form of governance, you can't just convert, because life is built up in such a way that there's a force or a pressure that inevitably denudes anything that tries to force a conversion. But what I often do, just rhetorically, is say, oh, come on, you know, at the basic level, what folks are saying, what we do say is, you know, and there's certain kinds of insights come from hunting or from ritual, which we've been doing this here for how long we've been doing this here. This is us, right? And there's a certain literal sense it can make. It's like, I remember the day one of the days it clicked. It was like, oh yeah, we've been stuffing this stuff in here for a very long time. And therefore, it literally is us. And thus, when we eat things that are from here, or we drink water or whatever, we are literally continually to co-constitute each other. We're building it, and it's building us. Ah, voila, so sensible. And I say that because then you can say, oh, yeah, see, it's not so different, it all makes sense.
And there's no problem with finitude.
There's no problem with finitude. And I didn't press on finitude. The finitude is really interesting because, and I'll come back to this, but I do want to say that that's the easy. And then what you would do rhetorically is drip, 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 drip until you got to the place that we got often to in land claims in some of these displaced locations, in which people say, no, I'm literally saying I was birthed from a water hole. And at that point, it was like, No, human beings do not come out of water holes. And, you know, I've written about this or someone has. There was a certain moment in which land commissioner said, this begs reason. Nobody would believe this. And therefore, it is a rhetoric designed to gain land rights rather than a belief, true belief. Yeah. So, and that drip is really important because it shows that there is a certain moment in which a division happens. Now, in terms of finitude, what's really interesting about this is that if you think, I'll give you an example and then I'll brace back to finitude. There's a movie that we're working on, blah, 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 but it came out of early days, it came out of what I should do with my archive, and a huge archive, which I do with my archive. And some older folks who I was talking to, what do I do with this thing? They said, dig a hole and burn it. And the way we do the second mortuary ceremony, the burning ceremonies, we dig a hole about this big and about this deep, and we burn our rags in it, you know, cover it up, stomp it, and then it's done. And they were basically saying, take your archives, do a Coptic ceremony with them, burn them, bury them, stomp over, finished. Because if it's not alive, if what's in it is not alive, it's not a mutual constituting, reconstituting, then it's dead, and like all things that are related to dead things, they should be put back in the earth, which was also a great meta-commentary, because in the very act of saying it's dead, they're saying, do what we do to reconstitute the earth, okay? So I was just like, okay, good.
No,
I'm digitized. No, movie's out of but it was very interesting, because it was like, I had a problem with finitude. But, you know, on one hand you say, well, some of these older women are really upset and angry and traumatized and mad at their kids. They're like, there's all ways in which I can psychologize this. But in some ways they were just like, if it's, you know, and the certain kind of like, well, you know, what's going to happen is that the earth is going to, like, if nobody does anything, the earth will just, you know, it's not going to die. It's just going to pull itself back and inward and pull itself away. It'll give backbone to humans and other things, give its backbone, which is to pull itself inward, which is to become a desert, and maybe something, and then it'll come back out again, maybe. But the drama was not the drama of human finitude as it's emerged in Western metaphysics, you could say Christian metaphysics, I don't know what to call it, but the drama of the human finitude, my personal death and the death of the species, it's like, well, I'm very upset when someone dies, but the drama is very different. And as a result, I think, if the question would, for me, and it's not a question, if you don't have the drama of the finitude the way we have it, do you actually allow a kind of life to flourish? Like, is the drama of finitude as defined by Western metaphysics actually leading to a much greater finitude than a drama which is not around finitude, which is more about giving each other backbone, pulling itself down, constantly reconstituting itself materially, you see? So what happens, and that's part of what I would do with these alternatives, what happens when we release ourselves from this fucking drama? And the Anthropocene climate change, it's just the drama on steroids. Oh my God, the human species. It's like, can we say who cares? Yeah, sorry, yeah. Do you want to?
Yeah, can I have another go?
Yeah.
And it's...
I enjoy this because this is work in process. So yeah.
It's another... I had the way it related to the multiple geoontologies, but okay, I'll go up that bit. But another thing that I was thinking is this old philosophical argument or claim that we begin with a gesture. And it's relating to your zeros and ones.
Yeah.
And I have, the philosophers I talk to have a great problem with what I do when I say, I'm just an empiricist.
I'm just an empiricist.
I don't make gestures. And it seems to me that that's,
yeah,
particularly your aunts and bay people, yeah, that there's no,
yeah,
gestures.
Yeah.
I'm just an empiricist. No, I'd rather not make gestures.
Yeah.
And I think that's very important for thinking about what do we do? And it really is just doing.
It's just doing it. And
and that's really important to keep saying, no, I'd rather not make a gesture.
Can it make it, how do we allow it to make its way through the world?
Yeah.
Can it find a space to be, to do?
Yeah.
Yeah. And
because
and
as soon as we've got the gesture, as soon as we've got the carbon economy, we've got finitude, and we've already lost it.
That's right.
I mean, you've lost me a little bit. I don't quite know.
Well, that's right. But
the gesture. So,
oh.
Well, philosophers say,
yeah, philosophers.
That to the first, the first gesture in philosophy is to make a gesture.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's the zero.
Yes.
Sorry, we're talking. We're
from nothing.
Yeah, to something.
To something.
That's right. And that's, you know, and again, the carbon imaginary absolutely depends on that. That, again, it's the numerical imaginary is underneath this, but it's a particular numeracy.
Yeah.
And that numeracy is, its drama is indeed radical birth. From nothing. How did we come from nothing, geochemistry, to something?
Yeah, yeah.
Life, right? And in our religions of the book, you know, in the beginning was the, what was it, emptiness or something?
Yeah.
The void. The void, you know? It was the void. And of course, it's like, what? Void. In the beginning was more, it was just a bunch of,
in the beginning was the beginning.
Yeah, it was the beginning. It was just, you know, like, there wasn't, what are you, I mean, it's not a drama.
Yeah.
And that's, it's like, there could be many dramas. And I think it's very hard for us to realize that, because we're so within the finitude and zero drama, that, no, there's the ones that are many ones, and things that begin in the middle, and that what, one of the reasons I tell the story of what people were doing across the harbor and still are doing is that it is not the drama of the zero in a tradition.
Yeah.
Right? Theirs was an analytics. It almost doesn't matter whether, like, you know, was substance and composition and obligation prior to settler colonialism or after settler colonialism. And it's like, why are we asking that? How does that relate to governing? Point is that they were saying, wow, what pops up in this context is a set of presuppositions that we clearly have had. Let's see if they work. Let's see if we can make them work to produce location in this radically dislocated world. Soccer blue, look at this, it's really, really working. Here comes the law of recognition. Sorry, you invented, or you know, you were being a theoretician rather than being a traditional repetition machine. That's a zero. And I think you're exactly right. I'm just an empiricist. I'm just
philosophers.
Bonkers. Bonkers. You should see the anthropologist do. Bonkers. Yeah. I think that's right.
Okay.
I think that's test with your book, what you're, it's like, what happens when I'm just going on?
Yeah, that was a useful clarification. Thank you. That's
And one last question.
I can go on and on.
when you're a ring in, when you're a sort of renegade ring into sociology, then you came into it without having a background in sociology, and you hear a fascinating lecture like this.
Yeah.
I feel a bit like a swan, you know, cool, calm, and collected on the surface and paddling like Helen or me to try and find those points that I can link into.
Yeah.
Am I being too naive to hear Peirce as being a sort of a very radical form of material semiotics?
Oh, you know, it's really interesting. That's a great question, actually. It's way not naive at all. Many people would, well, this is not an uncommon way of describing the American pragmatist as American phenomenology, but it's not the European phenomenology because of its, indeed, the way in which and I don't want to just repeat what you say, it's materialized semiotics, because I agree, I think it's like a material semiotics, but it is specifically so insofar as this, the way he takes the interpretant, that is the highest form of what he would consider his mental life, the logical, I mean, everything's a triadic structure, it's a logical interpretant. It's the like the creme de creme of rationality. A, he removes it from the brain and the bat and from language, because language is a particular kind of semiotics. B, he radically detaches it from abstraction, and thus
from
abstraction, and thus a particular kind of propositionality understood in, say, analytic philosophy. And he does so in this amazing way that's really weird and complicated, and I've read it a thousand times, and I still, there's a part of which I think I'm hallucinating, but the way he says it is that the object of the logical interpretant, so the object, the, what its object is, it's not abstract, it's habit. And we would say habit, like in prior to Peirce, outside of Peirce, in, say, analytic philosophy, we would say habit is that which impedes because the interpretant's object, its end, in a particular sense of end, is to be habitual, it's to make habit, it's to habitize, it's to habituate. It's to, like gravity. Gravity got into the habit of being. We're the effect of this, these histories of the interpretant, which got into the habit of being like this.
Like grooves.
Like grooves. Yeah, I'm not, sometimes James, I like, I've got, I used to hate James, I like James again for a particular reason, but like grooves. Like walking through a maze. Like things falling. And so when you're looking toward the end of the interpreter, you're not looking up in like abstractable propositionality. You're looking back into world. Thus, what kinds of interpretants can become habitual becomes a real question about force in the world. Theoretically, anything could. But it has to make its way. It has to have institutional life around it. It has to have kind of sociality that allows it to repeat over time so it can thicken or open, say, in a mangrove, and then other forms can grow out of it. So, yeah, materialized, it's radically material. It's radically phenomenological. It's radically toward the world rather than up into outer space. It's neither Aristotelian or Platonic, because it doesn't have that essence. It's not the acorn.
It's about clotting.
It's clotting. It's about clotting. Yeah, it's about clotting. Yeah, that's beautiful. Right. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will look forward to the next time we bring you three together and we ourselves here. This has been a really lovely series, and we'll have it on the website soon too.
Oh, really?
If you're happy with that.
Yep.
Well, we'll contact
I hate
you about that.
Fidget.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, join me again.